You're listening to the audio production of The Thing Beneath the Thing, What's Hidden Inside and What God Helps Us Do About It, by Steve Carter, published by Thomas Nelson and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
To Sarah Lynn, words can never fully describe who you are and what you truly mean to me. WATW, which means we against the world. My moment of madness. A few years back, while my wife Sarah and I were in the process of selling our Grand Rapids house in anticipation of a move to Southern California, we spent an evening sharing a meal with my grandparents. When snow flurries began to fall, Sarah and I put on our jackets and loaded our 8-month-old into our Honda Civic. Determined to get safely home before the storm set in, as I drove, a huge chunk of ice hit our windshield, cracking it. Startled, I swerved. The car slid across the icy street and came to rest on the opposite shoulder. In a state of shock, we tried to figure out what had just happened. Where did that chunk of ice come from? Then it occurred to me. Someone had thrown it. I quickly turned the car around, heading back to where the ice had landed. I pulled over, unbuckled, and leapt from the car. "I'm going to find them," I shouted back to my stunned wife. Off in the distance, I could make out figures running. "I see you," I screamed. "I'm calling 911 right now." I ran until I came to an embankment. Assuming it was filled with snow, I channeled my inner athlete and attempted to jump over it. I quickly realized that instead of snow, it was a puddle of icy water. Could I make it across? Nope. I landed smack in the middle of it. So now I was soaking wet, freezing, and getting madder by the second. "You can't get away from me," I yelled, crawling out of the embankment and resuming my chase. After running across a field, I came to a neighborhood. I stopped in the middle of the street and, because I watched CSI religiously, closed my eyes and listened. Immediately, I heard the growl of a garage door 3 houses down. I ran straight to the front door and rang the doorbell. At this point, I was completely worked up, going over everything I wanted to yell at the person once the door opened. The crack in my windshield, the ice-soaked run, the wife and son left behind on the side of the road. I was so ready to let this guy have it. But an older gentleman answered the door. "Hello?" Breathing hard, I quickly asked, "Did some guy just run in here?" He replied that he'd been home, but that his grandson and a friend had just come back in. I tried to keep my voice calm. "Can I talk to them?" Moments later, 2 junior high boys walked up to the front door, eyes wide, knees shaking, and obviously scared out of their minds. At this point, I heard the Spirit of God whisper, "Who is the crazy one here, you or them? Your wife and son are on the side of the road in a snowstorm, and you're standing here with soaking wet pants about to yell at some kids." And then the kicker. "What's really going on, Steve?" Standing on that welcome mat, eye to eye with those 2 freaked out students, I had a moment of clarity. I took a deep breath. "Nice shot," I said simply, and then turned back toward the car. With my legs nearing frostbite, I meditated on the question of what was really going on with me. In truth, I was grieving, preparing for a big move, saying goodbye to friends and family, and just hours earlier, I'd found out the buyers for our house had backed out. These things were taking up space in my head and heart, and they were looking for an outlet. What I didn't know at the time was that there were also deep, dark places hidden away in my heart, experiences that I had not fully realized, hurts that had formed deep crevices in my soul. These, along with my inability to trust God with my sadness and disappointment, had led me to give over precious inner territory to a rival force, and now I was acting like a wild man. The next day, I called my mentor and told him about my moment of madness. He laughed. "Welcome to the thing beneath the thing," he said. "Welcome to the endless discovery of what's really going on." Part 1. The setup that sets you off. Why do I do those things I do? Same as it ever was. Talking heads. Once in a lifetime. I do not understand what I do. From the Apostle Paul, Romans 7:15. When hearing about the moral downfalls of celebrities, pro athletes, government officials, pastors, or even neighbors, do you ever find yourself wondering aloud, what were they thinking? It's hard to imagine someone hopping out of bed one morning after hitting snooze a couple of times and saying, today's the day. Today, I'm going to completely sabotage all the good in my life and wreck my career, forfeit my integrity, and damage the relationships that mean the most to me. I think we can all agree that doesn't happen. So then why do those things come to pass again and again, over and over? Is the answer as simple as what Paul decreed almost 2 millennia ago? I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, I do. Romans 7:15. Is there no understanding for the choices we make? Can it be that life is just a thing that happens to us and we are unable to control our physical and emotional behaviors? Really? Over the last decade, I've become fascinated by this question of why people do regrettable things. Or better said, why do I do what I do? I've discovered there is always more at play than meets the eye. We can't presume to know what makes us or others tick. The more I grow in faith and self-awareness, the more I'm beginning to see up close that we are all mysterious and wild, a collection of sounds and stories inscribed over the years. We are all made up of hopes, fears, and desires. We are all products of the messages of love and shame we've received. We are all full of energy, excitement, and oh, so many feels. It's who I am. It's who you are. Sacred and holy. The weight of feeling not enough and way too much, often in the very same breath. Every room you walk into, you bring this. Your whole self. All of you. Yet most of the time, you and I are unable to locate and identify what is churning within. Like shadows that follow us, our outward attitudes and actions reflect the steps our internal world set. We've become functional, yet disconnected. Efficient, yet unaware. Our bodies carry both truths and lies. Every narrative we have ever been subjected to. Fiction, as well as nonfiction. The body knows, it holds, it controls all of us until we honor its whole truth. Where are you, really? We often work to silence and distract ourselves. We escape to those things we've learned can temporarily soothe us and create distance from the pain or sadness or shame we feel. A dear friend of mine once shared that his first recollection as a child was of falling, scraping his knee and crying. Jared walked to his mom with both arms raised, looking to be held and comforted. Instead, his mom handed him an Oreo and told him to stop crying. Just imagine it. Longing for the embrace of a parent and being handed 50 calories of milk's favorite cookie to make the pain go away. That day began Jared's lifelong battle of turning to food as the magic solution to make everything feel okay inside whenever he encountered painful experiences. Some of you might be thinking, come on, man. There are much worse things that can happen to a kid than being handed a cookie. But here's the deal. Kids are perceptive. They're just not the best interpreters of reality. Without helpful guides and mentors, they're left trying to make sense of and tangibly apply new information on their own. Sadly, the majority of the time, people grow up returning again and again to these unhelpful patterns of thinking and behaving. Richard Rohr wrote, "Using a scapegoat is our much preferred method. We deny our pain, sins, and suffering, and project them elsewhere. This ancient method still works so well that there is no reason to think it is going to end or change. Until we are enlightened by grace, we don't even see it. It remains safely hidden in the unconscious where it plays itself out. One Oreo became the genesis of an ongoing, unhealthy, intimate relationship with food that lasted years. This relationship sabotaged opportunities for connections with actual living humans. Until he was retrained to enjoy a healthy relationship with food, Jared felt powerless in situations of struggle, loss, and trauma. Patterns formed as a child seeking comfort eventually led to broken relationships, significant isolation, and cycles of deep sin. But if you had met Jared back then, before he identified what was really going on, you wouldn't have had a clue he was struggling in these ways. By all accounts, he seemed fine, totally together. You would have had no reason to conclude that his relationship with food was holding him back from true intimacy. And neither would he. When Jared and I first started meeting to discuss his commitment issues, food wasn't even on the radar. It took months for that realization to factor into our conversations. Welcome to the thing beneath the thing. 10 years ago, my wife wanted us to try a full-body detox for a few days. I said sure, not realizing what I was getting myself into. A few days turned into 28 days of removing everything that tasted good from our diet. A month of flavorless soup. Smoothies that rivaled composted trash liquefied. I'm not being dramatic. It was bad. About a week into this experiment, we became increasingly irritable, more tired, more emotional. What was happening? Apparently, the food we'd been putting into our bodies affected more than just our waistbands. And a lifetime of certain foods had made our bodies dependent on them. As we began to expel these toxins, the process became more holistic. All facets were affected, not just the physical, but the mental and emotional too. Specifically, when I removed soda from my regular diet, I became aware of how much I depended on the sugar and caffeine to give me that extra boost to make it through. Every day, around 3:15 p.m., I would drink a can of Dr. Pepper, i.e., the nectar of the gods. Without even realizing it, I'd become reliant on this pick-me-up. My dependency was not on the Holy Spirit to give me strength. Instead, my Holy Trinity was Father, Son, and Dr. Pepper. Taking soda away absolutely wrecked me for the first few weeks and sent shockwaves throughout my system. My joints ached. My body was fatigued. And every Sarah McLachlan dog commercial had me in tears. This was a strange wake-up call. Until that detox, I had no idea I was using substances to avoid parts of my life. I began to wonder, what other mediums am I attached to? What, other than the spirit, am I using to feed, comfort, soothe, numb, and help me escape my actual life? So I took inventory. Food, clothes, experiences, wine, sex, influence, opportunity, people, achievement, money, approval, comparing, goals, villainizing. What would happen if I replaced these things with the goodness of God? Would his peace truly be enough? I wasn't so sure. I really enjoyed Dr. Pepper. For the first time in a long while, I was in touch with my body, my feelings, my sadness, the deeper parts of me. And I absolutely hated it. For years, I had functioned from a place of detachment from this deeper self, wanting to silence the voices of contempt, numb the grief I had stored up, and escape. I'll save that story for another time. But suffice it to say, I was messed up. So I made myself busy, or bought something on a credit card with money I didn't have. I ran to food to soothe and drinks to comfort. I lost myself in social media. I villainized those who appeared further along, anything to excite the imagination and lead me away from me. I hurt those closest to me by constantly overpromising and underdelivering, only to later apologize. I expected my simple "I'm sorry" to make things better, but without committing to change, nothing changed for good. all the while I was unaware that my behaviors reflected my attempts to cover up agony, that I was afraid to let my true self be truly seen. I siphon the good out of an object, experience, or person to feed my needs, then moved on. Buying a new pair of shoes wasn't about delight. It was pure escape. Yet the pain became even louder, like an untamed beast raging.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.